Live. We're live. Hi, everybody. Welcome to Andy's Licorice Chat. This is now the 9th interview, and we have a very special guest from Los Angeles. It's Yehuda Gilad. Happy 4th of July to you, Yehuda. It's the 5th of July over here. Welcome.
Yeah. Well, it's great to be with you, and happy 4th, happy 5th. Every day has to be happy.
Yeah, very good idea. That's we decided we wanted to cheer people up during this period of time. So Yehuda has a wonderful memory in the back of Mallorca. Why don't you move and we can show his daughter doing yoga on the beach?
Yeah.
See, it's a happy family memory in the days when we were allowed to travel and take vacations. And we hope this period returns soon. Okay, Yehuda, come back, man. We miss you. Okay.
That's one of my favorite places there.
Yeah, really beautiful
item. Yeah.
Great memory. So I, as usual, I start off often on the ways that I know my guests. And in this case, I'm going to talk about more how I heard of Yehuda Gilad, and hopefully it'll spark some nostalgia with you. When I was a kid, maybe 35 years ago at Juilliard, I found a pianist that I did a lot of nice work with. And in one of the rehearsals, I went to her house and I saw an LP, right? And her name was Arlene Schrutt.
Absolutely. My beloved Arlene Schrutt.
Yes. Yes. So this was the first I heard of Yehuda as a clarinet player. And in 2011, fast forward, I don't know how many years, I went to Sydney and I gave a little class, and the pianist they used was Brenda Jones.
Oh yeah, of course.
Yeah, and she mentioned she mentioned that she was someone that I guess you use a lot at USC or something for
yes,
your clarinet.
Indeed.
Yeah. Indeed. So that's how I heard of him. Amongst other ways, of course, as a teacher directly. Now there's another connection that I've only just put two and two together with, and hopefully you can confirm it. You might get a kick out of it. I'm going to say 33 years ago, give and take, I played a summer festival in Waterloo, New Jersey, and there was an oboe fellow there named Kim. Does that sound right?
She's my wife, absolutely.
Yes. So this is Yehuda's wife. I'm not sure if you even met her then. Maybe she around?
No, she's not around. She's in our mountain house.
I wouldn't want to take her away from something
she
that
has
interesting.
A lot of fun right now. Yes, indeed.
Yes.
She remember those times fondly.
Yes. So I was actually, I guess I played in the, I was a dumb kid as opposed to a dumb adult now, but anyway, I guess in a way we played in the same orchestra 33 years ago. So that's a kind of fun connection. And of course.
And remember, I and my wife are still 39 years old.
Yes. That's amazing. You look about 30, man.
just as long as we keep the record straight.
Good. We wouldn't want to ruin a good story with the facts, you know?
Right.
So, and of course, I mean, way back in, I guess it was 2011 or 12, I had a sabbatical year. And I had a student, of course, or a grand student, rather, who was studying with you at Colburn, Natalie. Oh, nice shout out to her. So I went to visit and I met you for a day. I spent a day with you to see if I could observe any words of wisdom and all this. And here we are almost 10 years later connecting again. So it's really a pleasure. And now I need to say, very important for everybody, Yehuda had coronavirus and he's recovered and we wish him all well. He has all the antibodies and you know, just because of this period of time, you know, there's no use in avoiding all this. So why don't you just talk about it for 2 or 3 minutes, Yehuda?
Well, I came back from a trip in mid-March and 5 days later, I contracted something that felt like a very terrible flu with high fever, fatigue, and all that. At that time, my doctor did not, he immediately assumed that I have the virus, the coronavirus, from where I came from and all of the other indications. I just felt like it was awful, awful flu with cough and all of that that come with it. And the interesting part of it is that It's because I know there are some questions about certain drugs here and there, if it works or not. So he put me on this anti-malaria drug and the antibiotics. And after 7, 8, 9 days, it started to get really, really very, very good. And I recovered within 2.5 weeks altogether, all total. Now, obviously, it was not something that I wish on anyone. And please be safe and keep the distance. And it's not something that you'd like to get. But in the other hand, also, if sometimes in your life you took the flu shot and they missed the strain for that year, that's exactly what it felt like. It's like terrible flu, extremely terrible flu with breathing and all that. I'm happy to report, as you see, I'm very, very well indeed, and very, and as a matter of fact, with a renewed, absolutely energy and inspiration and love for life. So whatever, don't be afraid of it, but just know that it's something that you should watch for.
Thanks very much for sharing that. We really appreciate that, and we're so happy that you're here healthy and with a new, refreshed attitude towards life. So let's get to work. Why don't we just start from the beginning, okay?
Wow.
It is, well, it was only 39 years ago, right? Yeah. So let's start. I believe it was Israel. And why don't we talk just briefly about your life there, but also your musical influences and how you sort of came, how this all led to you coming to the United States?
Well, it's I was born on a kibbutz. In Israel, in the kibbutz, a small kibbutz called Gan Shmuel, beautiful kibbutz.
In two or three sentences, just, we have every kind of viewer for every age, every country. Just explain what a kibbutz is.
Kibbutz is so-called collective farm, it used to be. And now it's everyone share with the same goal of beautiful education, beautiful life, caring for each other, the education. It's unbelievable. They from 0 to 18. There's no better education in my opinion. And now I saw via my kids all the education that's done and stuff. It's fantastic. It's very, very caring, and it has a limitation. Like in anything, you have a limitation, but it's very humble. Humble. In other words, I remember. My mother had to squeeze 1 square of chocolate for every Hanukkah party. And she gave me a square. It was got 1 little square, which is fine. It was a hard time, shared by all. And I grew up, I think I give the credit for my total, becoming a total human being to, of course, my father and my mother, but also for the type of education I got from that particular education for ideals, education for philosophy, understanding, education for beautiful caring, and ideas, and the positiveness and the inspiration that I got from my father and mother. From their background in much, much less favorite times in Europe.
Yeah, my father lived on a kibbutz, so I'm really happy you spoke about that.
Which one?
Oh boy, now you're testing my memory.
Sorry.
Yeah, it's okay. We're here for you anyway, about you. So that's great, thanks for sharing that. And now let's move on how we, how music got into your life in Israel.
In my house, everything was around music, but it's not in the sense like now that somebody played the cello or somebody played violin. My parents loved to sing. They sang all the time. That was part of their inner body. But in the kibbutz, because it divided a little bit differently, and I'm not going to get into it, we all of us in my age level start on a little recorder. We all played recorder for a long time. We had a beautiful, beautiful musician that played mandolin that identified that I might have some talent. Mind you, now I'm close to being 16 years old. That's when I started the clarinet. I didn't start in 16 or 16 and a half. And he said, maybe I went to a seminar and maybe I'll see if I can teach you to play the clarinet. So we got a old jalopy clarinet and I started to blow a few notes. Apparently, he couldn't keep the pace with me because I had some talent. I have some gift. So the kibbutz decided to allow me to go to the city to study with one of the at that time the Israeli Philharmonic member Gior Feidman, which you all know, Gior Feidman. And I remember used to take the bus. It took me 2.5-3 hours to go practically a distance in the car, it's 45 minutes. Anyway, and once a week I traveled there and studied with him. So that's after a year that I was playing.
Wow. So, and how long did you study with Gior Feidman?
On and off, I would think 4 to 5 years, maybe.
Wow. Yeah. So, I mean, obviously, we know him as a you know, unbelievably soulful musician, and particularly in klezmer. But presumably you were studying mostly classical or traditional or maybe not.
Gior, you can say many things about Gior, but he's most definitely not traditional at all. and I love him dearly, really. I have many anecdotes that some of them I can share, some of them I cannot share.
we want the ones he can't share.
of course. But the anecdote is he's an extremely caring person. He took me under his wings. And, you know, he taught me many things. I would not think necessarily the exact technique of the clarinet, but he taught me many things that are important in making music, in making phrases, in making natural, in building up my natural aptitude of a phrase. He's absolutely marvelous musician and very, very close and a marvelous human being, I think. I consider him one of my two big mentors, and but he had many things. He made me do things that not related to the clarinet, which is fantastic, but some of them is not for the public. Yeah. And today, he won't survive maybe today, even in this politically correct thing.
Yes.
But nothing, never abused, nothing. It was really, really excellent. Really very beautiful, and I feel blessed that he was in my life at that period.
I had a my own memorable. I certainly didn't know him nearly as well as you, but when I was a kid in New York, I started playing duets on the street. I put the hat out and hopefully get a few dollars. And I was playing on the street, and who comes in and puts $5 in but Gior Feidman? And I was just like, oh no, do I have the right reader? And he puts $5 and he goes, and I maybe it was bassoon duets, I don't remember. I turned, I said, that was Gior Feidman, blah, blah. And at that moment, a police officer came over and wrote me a check, a ticket for $145.
Oh,
I still remember. But amazingly, I went to see my teacher, Leon Rushinov, a couple of hours later, and there was Gior Feidman visiting with him, and I said, oh my God, thank you so much. He goes, oh, you're the guy I put the $5 in. I told him I got the ticket. And I remember he was actually angry. He says, we're trying to bring beauty to this world. You're playing beautiful duets on the street and they punish you for it. And that's my very memorable experience with him. So I'm sure you had a lot of amazing times. Is there anything more specific to the clarinet that you remember that helped your foundation or even musically?
Oh, there are many. Where I can, starting with, mind you, I was a novice practically because in my first year I studied with a guy who just played mandolin. So I happy just to learn the fingering on the things and to think. So I was a little bit in shock for the first 2 years. And then I came up with, and he taught me many, many things. He taught me quiet fingers. He taught me that everything has to be quiet, and quiet in a sense of not a show off. Quiet, it comes directly from within you, which is one of the things that I teach all around right now. And he taught me, he gave me various exercises that he was doing. One of them I refused, and I would never give it to anybody, even though it was very good exercise. You want to?
Yeah, we want to hear, but at this stage, I don't know what we're allowed to say or not.
So, yeah. So one day we're going to, I come to his house, and he's like in those machines that you can tie yourself and you can go practically like that, and your head is on the bottom. You know, this machine that you tie yourself and you will come with your head on the bottom. He said, oh, that's fantastic. He said, the blood comes here. In here, I'm playing. It's fantastic. It's fantastic. He said, Gyoa, this exercise I would not do. Oh, but you sure? Oh, but you sure? You have to do it and stuff like that. I will never forget it. Speaking of which, what I took it is the larger idea that the more conventional you play and the posture, the more conventional in the, this is the way to play, is really quite wrong because it's completely not natural. So what this part of it, he didn't have barriers of, I have to be like that and like that. Huh. As you know, he was Leonard Bernstein's favorite bass clarinet player. To hear his sound on the bass clarinet in orchestra and now in klezmer, it's just unbelievable. I think Lorenzo would have appreciated.
Oh, hey, Lorenzo, come here. Okay. We forgot to introduce you. This is our good friend Lorenzo, wonderful bass clarinetist and techie coordinator, so to speak. Thank you so much.
I agree with you.
Yeah, it's practically the sound that he got out of this instrument was so not only expressive but so hugged all who heard it. I was lucky enough to hear him play many of the Mahler symphonies when I was younger, going to the Philharmonic and hear it. And Mahler, Shostakovich, and all of that, and the bass kind of can't play. It was balanced, but it was so, wow. I was dumbfounded to hear him play. It was just so unbelievable. Longest phrases in the world, and not breathing. And mind you, his eyesight was really failing him. So he practically memorized two bars ahead of what he had to play, and then he back and played. So I have so much love and respect for him and for what he not obviously achieved. He achieved tremendous, but love and respect for the human being in him. Yeah. And so.
Just before we move on, I'm just curious. You refused to do his exercise and you actually said, but what it taught you was traditional posture on the clarinet is not necessarily the best. What do you recommend as a...
Okay, by the way, let's correct here. This particular exercise of being hanged heads down, I refused to do it. But the rest of it, I did. And I'm not going to tell you which one.
Okay.
and they were fantastic. They brought something different to our mind. So I believe it has to be as natural as possible, a posture. If you sit, I remember in some classes that I took, somebody said, you have to sit straight, like almost 90 degree when you sit to the floor. It's absolutely wrong. The shape of your spine, of your particular spine, the shape of your abdominal muscles are completely wrong. When you sit like that, sometimes I said to people, how will you go to a bar and sit in the bar? So obviously, you don't want to say, hey man, how are you doing, like this. Obviously not, but you will sit like that. This is the natural, what I'm sitting right now, this is the natural way I will sit, where my back has the layover to be able to expand very, very well from the back, and that I can breathe with a gravity going down. Remember the idea of gravity. The more you go like this, you're doing something that is completely unnatural, like this. The more you let the gravity goes in, and you design the breathing this way, you go down and then, and nothing, all of that has to relax. Everything has to be natural. The whole body has to be much more inviting for the client to join as a part of you, not as a foreign object goes into your mouth. Mm. It has to be absolutely organic how you take the client. For instance, I also believe that this is absolutely not natural, like this with the elbows, and this is also not natural. You know, you shake the hand of somebody, of your friend, and just bring it naturally here. If you kind of work on not disturbing the body to do its natural things, the body therefore will act much, much more beautiful and better with your breathing, with your volume of breathing, with identify where all the colors has to come from. So sorry, I'm
becoming... No, please don't apologize. Okay. Like, please, this is what we're this is what we want. This is what we want. Wonderful.
But you asked the questions.
Guilty. Well, that's great. So 4 or 5 years with Gior Feidman. Now you're how old? You started later in life.
I was then around 21, 22 maybe.
Okay, so what now? How did you get to the States, or did you do military?
Yes, of course. I did three and a half years military, and part of it was in with the Israeli military band, and part of it not. But part of it was the Israeli military band, and it was supposed to be 3 years that we have required duties, but it was a war in between, so it was delayed. So I got out of the army after 3.5 years, of course.
Right. And, you know, I've talked to Israeli musicians, or I mean, Korean musicians, at places you have to do this. Is this maybe it's a stupid question, but it wouldn't be the first time. I mean, is this a big disruption to musicians in Israel? Is it viewed that way very much, or is there something you actually benefited from it?
Let me put it this way. It was definitely not ideal.
Yeah.
But it's also, it's very interesting. I'm going to say something, maybe other people will disagree with me, but very interesting that, you know, now I'm teaching many years in this system as well as all around the world. And of course, it's not ideal to be in the army and to do what needs to be done. And even in the Israeli military band, it's not something that it would be very as inspiring, but it teaches you how to think better to improve. It teaches you to create projects for yourself to improve. It motivates you to say, I have two choices, either to be, to just go and be discouraged in everything, or to try to find beauty in the midst of everything. That's number one. Number two, I see, for instance, a high school graduate for in United States, and again, I love them all, and I teach them all. Some of them, not all. God, no. but I see, when they graduate by the age of 18, the first 4 years, I call it finding yourself. They find yourself, really go and live and do things that are, that make you much a little bit more maturity, get other, a lot of experiences. So in a sense, the first 4 years of college, or first 2 years at least, are the really extended high school period in the United States. A maturity level is not as much as when, I remember when I had to go to the army at the age of 18, like at that time, I went to the army and I matured in 1 year. I matured very, and not only because of the necessity, because I'm a man of peace, but the necessity of dealing with completely different surroundings and different people. You get to recognize new people, new way of doing things, and it make you become much more mature slowly and slowly. I think the army that in that regard did for me, it was a good thing to do, even though at the time I wish I didn't do it.
I understand. No, I mean, this is so wonderful. First of all, again, we're so happy that you're healthy, and but you've been through COVID. And what you're, part of the purpose of this is to show that you have the choice of attitudes, and you can turn negative things into something positive. Or, you know, now before we go on, there's so many fans here that are all sending their love, but. John Bruce Yeh, Maria Wong, of course, Pascual Martinez. But one person in particular, we love you, Frank Cohen, who turned me on to the book, Man's Search for Meaning by Viktor Frankl, who was in a Nazi concentration camp. And his whole thesis is, you know, some people just wanted to commit suicide. Some people just gave up and died. And he chose to create a whole new school of psychiatry because of this. And he says that's the only thing they can't take from you is how you choose to deal with that situation. So I really appreciate what you just said. I mean, it's really amazing. And, you know, it just ties into this period for all of us. So that was great. Thank you so much. Yeah. So you finished the army. And now you're what, 24 or 25, or I don't know.
No, I was 22.
22, yeah, okay. And now what? So, 22. What was going on now?
Then I went back to the kibbutz and I work in various jobs and I practice like hell. I did some recording of the Paul Ben Chaim Pastoral Varié. That's with the kibbutzim orchestra or whatever. And then I left first in England. I spent around a month or two, I don't remember exactly, in England. I was taking few lessons from the great Yonah Ettlinger, which I appreciate very much his playing. And then I was accepted at various schools, but I decided to go to work with Mitchell Lurie in Los Angeles.
Well, we definitely want to hear about that. But before we go on, I mean, a lot of us have heard of Yonah Ettlinger, but we don't know that much about his teachings, and so we've heard recordings and things. I mean, what things did he impress upon you?
Or he was a great musician, and I think if you hear now the old string quartet and clarinet, Brahms and Mozart with the old Tel Aviv quartets. Chaim Taub and him playing, it's practically one of my favorite recordings. that he was a marvelous, marvelous player. He passed away in his early 50s, very, very young from heart attack. He taught at the Guildhall School of Music, and he taught in Paris Conservatory for a while, Yona Etlinger. And he was very methodical and very, for every single note, he has to be just right. And he very, very patiently, but he was extremely coming out of Graphite when he was like the very different in many ways, but getting to the same goal, I would say.
Wow, yeah. Just a quick footnote, Lorenzo, a few years later, was also a teacher at the Guildhall.
Uh-huh. I just gave a virtual class there.
Really? Oh, great.
In the school there. Yeah.
Oh, terrific. Wonderful. So now we're going to get to the United States, where you've been for a few years now.
Few years. Everybody that knows me said that Los Angeles is the base, but I, up till now, of course, COVID, everything changed. I kind of traveled like almost 5 to 6 months a year.
Okay.
Traveling and doing what I love the most, meeting new people, new musicians, and trying to help people as much as I can.
Great. So now you were in a degree program at USC with Richard Lurie?
No, it's like a special study because I at USC, yeah.
Great, and it was with Mitchell Lurie?
Absolutely, Mitchell Lurie. I studied with him 4 years.
So, 4 years, wow. So, please, I mean, I think this is so great. I'm always trying to get the giants of the past in here for people and document a little. So you would be a great vehicle to just explain a little bit about him and his teachings and all that.
I think many people can because the thing about Mitchell Lurie is that it was such, you could not find one mean bone in his body. It was absolutely a giant, and the ethics and the attitude and the care, of course, is second to none. And he practically, Mitchell Lurie, my first period in United States was not very, very easy because of the fact that I come from a kibbutz, so money was not there for me, you know. And the reason I mentioned, because I lived on a couch of some people on the couch, and I had to work sometimes in the gas stations and things like that. And Mitchell used to take me home from school, used to drive me to my home, and because I didn't have much. But this is, again, there's no complaint. Again, once again, I would not change a thing, even the first 2 years that I had so much difficulty, and never complained once. And I will never change a thing because it helped me become who I am today. Absolutely. You have to, you cannot, I believe that Mozart, and for a different reason, Mozart, Schubert, and all the greatest composers struggle. They had a rough life for a reason or another. So again, I don't mean to say that I would like people to struggle, but there's some virtue and some appreciation and understanding if you go through this. And so people, just remember, I would not change those two pairs. Mitchell used to drive me occasionally because I had to take like 3 buses, you know, to get to where I am. And as you know, Los Angeles is not a very easy.
LA without a car, I can't even imagine. Wow.
Yeah, it was dreadful. A dreadful period as far as that's concerned because it took so much long. One of the reasons that I developed so many of the exercises that you saw my students do or you saw me do, exercise is I develop it because not the ability to practice in a place where I was living for the first 2 years. I had to wake up at 4 o'clock in the morning. Then I practiced silently with developing the straw, developing the ping pong, developing many, many of the exercise that some people are doing all around the world. I'm not going to mention all of them. Developed so many things, my way of the inner stream voice and things like that, because I cannot practice with sound. So that's, for me, always sound, it's what I have inside, because and when I put the clarinet on, immediately the sound, for me, is sound something that it's coming from my heart, from my soul. So I never actually necessarily work to develop the sound. I worked on develop my sound. And that's small distinction, but huge distinction. Mm. Work to develop your sound. And with my way of doing, with my mouth, with my face, with my chin, with my everything. And that helped. And Mitchell let me do that. And he helped me. And he gave suggestions that are right spot on the money. I'll give you another little interesting part. When I came to the States, because I didn't really put the tongue on the reed. I found it when Mitchell asked me, you don't put the tongue on the reed, do you? I did. Or I just put maybe the tongue touch occasionally, but I didn't know nothing. And he said, you don't put the tongue on the reed, do you? I said, what are you talking about? And he started to show me, okay, fine. And he taught me many, many of the concepts. He said, try this, and all of the things, until he found what works the best for me. And from there, once again, I took it as a plus, the way I didn't know something, and I had to learn something, and I find many, many ways that I teach right now. So there's many things that contribute to where I do it, beside the fact that I always love sharing the world.
Yehuda, about how old was Mitchell Lurie when he recorded it? It was what, Mozart quintets and all, and was it Brahms quintet also? Or
I probably will be mistaken. His brother will call me up on it. His son. But he was in his 70s then, 75. Right. He was, and this is absolutely divine recordings. I have it right here. I listen to it a lot.
Well, that's what I wanted to share with you. I've only had one experience with this guy that you've described so beautifully. I heard this CD. I don't even know when it was. 25 years ago? Does that make sense? When it was released? I don't know.
Maybe less, maybe 15.
Okay, and I heard in, like you, I really loved it. And I can't even remember how I got his phone number, but I just, as a stranger, I just called him up. I said, hi, you know, I live in Hong Kong. I just heard your CD. I just want to tell you, you sound like $1 million. You know, I said, what mouthpiece are you on? Or some, you know, typical geeky, stupid, you know. And, you know, immediately he took down my address and he sent me the mouthpiece as a gift. And that's the only experience I ever had with him live, you know.
He was a very special man. There's nothing. He was practically my second father in, not only in Los Angeles, but really we were conversing practically every day for a while. And I feel very, very blessed to have those two mentors that I had.
Great.
And by chance, you know.
As I mentioned before, we have a mutual friend, colleague, you know, in your case, student, Hermann Stephenson, the principal clarinet of the Stockholm Phil, which who studied with, I don't know, 30 years ago or something like that. He said
he's with me. I'm 19. I'm not going to tell you, but he would be pissed if I'll tell you when he started.
He's only a year older than me, so don't make me feel self-conscious, Yehuda. he said maybe that he was there during the period of time when Mitchell passed away. Does that sound right?
I don't think so.
He would have been there earlier, I guess. But he said that when he did pass, you sent something out to a sort of community. I don't know what it would have been, email or something, and you called him something like, you know, the father of the family. It was a very touching email and a great tribute that you sort of passed on. And he says this is a lot of your mantra, like you know, the students, the tribe, the family, the team, you know. And he says clearly now you've sort of taken the mantle of that. Of you know the father now, and it sounds like that was a big influence.
It was big influence in many areas. Yes, and we did a tribute to him, and he was very touched. I still have the note he wrote to me, but I don't remember exactly. It was so. He said, "So much love to you from your rabbi."
Right.
That to me meant a lot. Yeah.
Beautiful. Yeah. So now,
here's my dog. My dog just arrived because they started the fireworks. So,
oh.
Guinness, look. Oh, I have to get this thing out. Just 1 minute. Hello, everybody.
Man. I was on virtual vacation a minute ago.
Guinness.
Oh, beautiful. Fantastic.
Yeah.
Very cute.
Yeah. So anyway, that's my dog. His name is Guinness, after the beer Guinness, you know?
Beautiful. Can you do me a favor and put back my orca?
Of course I'm going to put
back my orca. Thank you, man. We all want to have a virtual holiday right now.
Absolutely.
Oh, great. I'm in a good mood again. Thank you. Your dog also put me in a good mood. Okay, so now, as I said, the very first time I heard about you from Arlene, you know, 35 years ago, here were recordings of you as a player, okay? And, you know, now, as I told you before, you know, I studied with Leon Rushenoff, who he sort of started out, you know, as a youngster, the umbrella of clarinet, you know, and eventually he found his calling was in pedagogy and education. When did you sort of know that you had this calling to go in? When did you make sort of an identity shift and say, okay, I'm Yehuda Clarinet, Yehuda the clarinet teacher, professor, this is really who I am? And when did you know you had this talent or whatever to bring out the best in people?
It's very interesting. My my beloved students, he tell Bert Hara was one of my students, studied with me 4 years when he was in high school, and I felt the calling much very, very early in my career for teaching. But I remember I say to a friend of mine that I have three areas that I was concentrated. Each one sometimes a little bit more heavy on this, sometimes heavy on this. One is, of course, performance. The other one is conducting. The other one is teaching. But each one of them, it's not that I want to be a teacher. It's not that I want to be a conductor. It's something that I enjoy to play and to do whatever I can to share with people my musicianship. For instance, in my opinion, the calling, yes, is a teacher, but I call myself a guide, more a guide, to guide a person from zero to life, you know, to guide a person. So A, the wellness to play with the body beautifully so you would not get hurt 5 years into your professional life. The idea how to reach a person, and that's why I don't write books, because individuality, I fit my concept. Some are general, absolute general, but most of the time when I have a student, it's changeable from a person to person. And I fit those concepts, and even the wording that I say to certain students are not the same. So because it's very individual. I have this calling, and I love teaching. I love discoveries. I love discoveries of my body as it relates to a singing. And I like, so that's why very early in my career, I already did an MRI of my neck to see what happened there, or my vocal cords through a camera, or all of that now many people are doing, of course, to realize what you're doing actually inside when you're singing. Huh. So I find this calling, but the most important part of it, one of my favorite classes that I did audit at USC was philosophy. And what I mean by that is to understand emotion, to understand logic, to understand cause and effect. If you say something, what the effect will be. And it taught me many, many things, which I attribute of my being today. Because, for instance, I happen to have the knack, the talent of diagnosing something, somebody's issues or problem very, very quickly. I can hear like two seconds and diagnose it precisely where is the problem. Exactly where is the problem of this particular person. And then I do some more series of checkup, and then I will always offer a solution. You cannot just identify the problem and say, maybe you should do that, maybe you should do that. You have to offer a solution so the students get the understanding of the problem and understanding how to get the solution to solve the problem by themselves, because after all, they will have to become their own teacher when they get into the profession. They won't have a teacher every week. And so for me, it becomes very easy to do so. And I believe in diagnosis and offering a solution. It's a little bit similar to a doctor and diagnosing something, and you prescribe antibiotic. If you are allergic to this antibiotic, I'll give you another one. Yeah. But it's very, very important, because sometimes, especially young students, want to imitate what you're doing. But that's imitation, it's not you. And I believe, it will take them a little bit longer to get where they want to get, but then once they get it, it's theirs, and nobody can take it away from them. So yes, I realized that this is a calling very early in my life. And sorry, my dog is here.
It's okay, we love your dog. We want to see you at home.
Now they have these fireworks all around me, and they're kind of freaking out. So, sorry, I apologize. Sorry, I didn't say it to anyone.
It's okay. We're all sitting anyway, don't worry. Yeah.
So where was I? So anyway, so that was part of the teaching, the performing. Mm-hmm. My love is chamber music. My love is to perform. And you know, my resume said where I was, it's fine, I don't. But it's not about me. I always wanted to share with people. And so sometimes that performance part of it, obviously in the beginning, the first 20 years or first 10 years was much more massive than the teaching or the conducting. Conducting I started later, and enjoy what I do. It's not something that is a jet setter conductor for my pride and my fame and all that thing. You know, it's for a specific reason. To hear, to make music with a large or small ensembles, and to get the full pantrum of colors, not only a little bit when you're in the orchestra sometimes, that's what we hear an unbalance. I like to get the full picture. And so that's why I chose that, but never lost my clarinet or my teaching. So those three elements are very important to me, and they stayed very important.
But, you know, we all know you so well now, and specifically as a teacher, and I know doing conducting as well. How can we connect a little bit to you in the early days as a performer? What do you have recordings that are still printed that are?
Yeah, there's some Spotify. You have the recording I did with this, and there's a lot of tapes. I don't know if it's around. I was in Malgo Festival, and so there are some archive recording, but most of the recordings are on reel to reel or a regular tape. Some LPs that I made few, but there are, I don't know, as a matter of, you should have gotten the LP because they are not existed anymore, the one
that I'll try to connect with Arlene and see if she has an extra
I have many recordings of a recital myself, of that I gave a recital, chamber music, and some are great that I can vouch for, some are less than great, you know, like all of us.
Yeah. if you're lucky. Yeah. Wonderful. And so when did you sort of, you said conducting came later, when did you sort of feel that avenue, discover that avenue in your connection with it?
Well, in mid 80s, that's probably mid 80s, so it's later because I was already here and everything, mid 80s. And then I discovered, because it's very interesting anecdote that probably people will kind of say, wow, what a weird, he had the job. There was a chamber orchestra, a part-time chamber orchestra in Los Angeles called the Peninsula Chamber Orchestra. It was run by music director Doug Lowry, he should rest in peace, he passed away. Beautiful man. And I was the principal clarinet of this orchestra. After a year of its existence, I went to Doug and I said, Maestro, I think I'm not the best clarinetist you can find. Find a little bit better. I just didn't feel at home playing in the orchestra. And I went, again, I needed the money, but I said, look, I'm not the best for it. I'm being very honest. And he said, no, you're fantastic, blah, 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 blah. I said, no, give it to somebody that's their calling. And sure enough, everybody was, what? Why? But that's something, work that you can have. So I left it. And I realized that I really loved the orchestral literature. And at that period of time, I met a Dr. Herbert Zipper, which is a Holocaust survivor. And he was, as I mentioned before, he was the assistant, informal assistant of Richard Strauss when he did the opera. He apparently, and Herbert von Karajan, but Herbert Zipper, to cut, it's kind of shortening the things, he was taken to Dachau, and then from there he escapes through the Philippines, through everywhere.
Wow.
His story is unbelievable. Herbert Zipper, great man. But what I learned from him, it was fascinating. I learned, of course, the conducting shape and things, but also I learned we used to sit every week for hour to 2 hours, just sitting and talking about what Richard Strauss said about Brahms. He was the teacher, you know, he admired Brahms. And how did Richard Strauss said that to do the Brahms third symphony, what did Brahms say about it? Because they knew each other. So this for me was priceless. Or in a Shostakovich five, we studied there, or we did all the Brahms, all the Beethovens, all the Mozart, all the thing. The study in length and practicum, exactly with what he passed to me as his pupil. And the discussion was amazing. I now wish that I would have recorded everything, but I didn't have the facilities as much. But so he is the one, and so I became his assistant conductor. And from then I got the Santa Monica Symphony Orchestra in Santa Monica, Los Angeles. And then I got the Colonial Symphony of New Jersey. I did there 15 years as their music director. And then I came back, well, in between I was also music director from the 20th century new music in Santa Fe, New Mexico. And then I did, and then I do some occasional guest conductors, either only with winds or with orchestras and various like that, very interesting. And
Hermann said you did something with the Stockholm Phil, in fact, right? The winds,
yes,
or something.
Yes, we did a project with them. It was fantastic. I loved it. Mm. We did a project with them, and I did one in the radio orchestra in Norway as well. And I did something, I do a lot of those. They have, in Europe, they have 1 week of orchestra projects, and I kind of fill in when they need me on this, and that's a conducting thing. And so I do some guest conducting, and I'm the music director and the conductor of the Colburn Orchestra, which is a beautiful, beautiful orchestra. And work and conduct some of the concert, and some of them bringing guest conductors, like for instance, one of the great addition is Esa-Pekka Salonen. He teaches conducting there now. And bringing people such as Ludwig Merlot and some great, great names that are now conducting all over. Mm. So I'm quite pleased and quite content in what I'm doing.
I remember when I spent that day with you, when we visited Colburn, Sir Neville Mariner had just conducted. He was on his way out, the late Sir Neville.
That's right. He came, came twice or three times I invited him.
Great.
We become very, very close friends. He he knew Dick Colburn from a long time ago.
Wow.
When he was the conductor of the Chamber Orchestra, Los Angeles. And so Neville, he walked into one concert that I did with the orchestra there. We did Ginastera, Dance Variazione, and he heard this.
Bye, goodbye. I've heard enough. I'm calling in sick.
She nailed it. She I'm still all the way. Boop, it was fantastic, and it was a really great performance. So he walked in and he said, "Oh, I'm in the wrong place." It's good already. Anyway, and I brought him. We become very good friends. He was, and now the friendship extended with Andrew as well. And I'm very thankful for that.
Yeah. Wonderful. Yeah. So let's just clarify. You're the professor and music director at Colburn and USC.
That's correct.
Right. And do you have, you mentioned Scandinavia. So obviously now, you know, internationally, everyone knows who you are, but it seemed that there was a kind of getting here. There were three parts of the world that you were particularly focused on or known in, and Scandinavia, Spain, and Korea. Do you think I have it right?
Yeah, partially, I think. I think you have it right. I think I did some work in, obviously, all throughout Scandinavia. That means all those four countries there, and Finland and Denmark and Sweden, Norway, extensively. I did some work in Belgium. I did some work in earlier in France, and I do a lot of work. One of my favorite festivals is in Murcia, Spain, which I go there at least twice a year.
Right. Sorry to interrupt. So I just want, obviously you do a lot of guesting and stuff, but are there sort of regular places that you do, as you say, every year? So people who can't make it or don't make it to Los Angeles, and hopefully with things loosening up one day, where can they see you regularly? Are there two or three festivals every year that we see you at?
I would start with Murcia first of all. That's in Spain. This is a festival that, and then I do something together with my former student Venancio Rios, also something in Madrid. But the Murcia festival with Jonathan Rivas and Manuel Rivas is one of the best organizational mind, and I love it. It's intensive 1 week or week and a day or something less, sometimes more, of climate studies. Everyone come, everybody get their lesson with a piano, with everything. You eat unbelievable food in Spain, and those are the festivals that I've done now 9-10 years.
And around what time of year would that be?
So we usually have December and May.
Okay.
Obviously, the festival we had in the beginning of March last year, it was in Altea. It's a new festival, but it's also organized by Jonathan Rivas. So it was in the beautiful city of Altea. So I came back from there. I do also some other engagement in Madrid and in Compostela and some other areas. I did some in Sevilla and areas, some other areas in Spain. And I think so this is one hub that I love going every year. And of course, in Mallorca, which Pascual is from there, my own student. I love Mallorca, as you see the picture behind.
He's making comments all the way. Oh, he's loving this, Pascual.
Yeah, so we're going, we have a timeshare in Son Antem, Mallorca, which is a beautiful place. And obviously I met his parents, everyone, his family. It's very precious time. You see how much I love all my students. So if I didn't mention all of the hundreds of them, please, my apologies. But you asked me about Spain and things like that.
Oh, no, of course. Please don't bother.
Obviously in Scandinavia, very often in Finland, in the Kursel Festival.
Okay.
And together with a good friend of Harry Maki of course, Olli Leppäniemi, my own former student in the Sibelius Academy. And so I did week, many times I came there and shared and worked. And in Sweden, nonstop practically, I joined forces with Herman I'm joining forces with him in two festivals this coming year. One of them is the Aurora Music Festival that I do every year. And every year is supposed to be in the summer, but unfortunately it was delayed this time because everything was closed. So it will be probably in October, late October. And the other festival that I do with Herman in Framnäs, in up north in Piteå. And this is, by the way, one of the ideas that we all had, which was fantastic. I call it the Piteå 12. What I mean by that is that very long time ago, I was coming with a suggestion that I would come. There was a festival, it's a regular masterclasses that where you choose 12 people and you give each one three lessons in 1 week, 12 students, and they come back again and again and again. So if you are there 3 years or 4 years together with the summers four times, but in 3 years you practically get almost what they will get at USC in the amount of lessons, in a sense.
Yes.
So I had 12 regular students there that come and practically religiously, when obviously when they could, and they got it and they become my students. The people that you probably know them is Bjorn Niemann, Andreas Sundin, Christian Stennis, Svante Vik, Lotta. I mean, I had so many unbelievable players, all the Lepaniemi, which after they came to USC, and some others. If I forget the 12, I didn't mention the 12, please forgive me. But that's that is the type of masterclass I love to give. Obviously, I like to meet people for one time. You come and give the masterclass, you inspire them, you give them one thing to work on, not bunch of things to work on, so they can don't freak out and will be able to digest and they go away. Fine, I that's good. There is value in that. But the thing that I like really is to have some kind of regularity of people who come to the class time and time again. So I can start to give them methods and to see how it works, and to be able to check them in a very, very regular periods. And this is the true learning. It's not a one-time shot and then for the person to say, oh, put a flower on the note and a cloud on the another note, but it's to get into the essence of how you better can find your own voice. And so that's what I liked about the Peter Orr thing. That's what I like about Murcia.
By the way, just to interrupt, we've mission accomplished with your background. Michelle Zukovsky just got on and she says, Yehuda, where are you? She sees the background, she's completely, she says hello, of course, and she's agreeing with supporting a lot of your points there, one thing at a time in a masterclass and so on. So I just had to bring that in. By the way, Herman also said, when you develop your following, so to speak, in Scandinavia, the same people would always come and show up to watch your masterclasses, and they were nicknamed Yehuda's Witnesses.
Oh God, I didn't hear that one before. Oh God, no. Oh my God, Herman, I have something to talk to him about.
He's still asleep, but he promised that he'll watch when he wakes up, so don't worry about it. Just a few other festivals. I've noticed you sometimes at Banff. I mean, it's good to just get out there where people can study with you when they're not in California.
Yeah, well, so sometimes I'm in Banff, but the Banff, the program that I did is no longer exists.
Oh, okay.
Changing it, but in Banff, in Domaine Forger, I am in the National Orchestra Institute in Maryland. I'm there. And that's about it in the United States. But I go very often. I was supposed to give a 2 days in Lausanne, for Florent students and the Pascal Moragues. Mm-hmm. But of course it's been delayed. All my 9 festival was canceled. And this summer.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. But speaking of Florent, his wife she's doing quarantine here in Hong Kong, Maria Wong, and she says hello, of course. And Charlie Nydick and Ayako Shima say hello. They're tuned in here. And so too many people to include, but once in a while I feel like interjecting. So
Maria is very interesting, because Maria also worked with Natalie, of course.
Yes.
She's such a precious, special person. And I remember she brought her to Korea or Yeah, I think it was Korea or Taiwan. No, probably Korea. She brought her when she was 12 years old.
Right.
12 years old. And then she and John came with little Natalie. It was very special. Since then, I developed very close with Maria, and of course now with Florian, with her, and
Natalie.
Natalie, now she become, I don't know if I'm a grandfather or I'm a, you know, whatever. know. Very special, very special.
Wonderful, yeah. So that's who I visited when I met Yehuda. She's now principal in Tampa in the Florida Orchestra, right?
Right,
And from Hong Kong, of course. So, great. So what is there something? What do you look for when you have students auditioning for you? When you actually have to accept them into something rather than going to a festival? What are you looking for?
It's very interesting that you ask me, because this question I'm being asked quite often, and every time I kind of pause a little bit because it's very hard to answer, obviously. But what I'm looking for in generality is somebody to tell me their stories, not anybody else's, even though if it's not complete, their stories. Somebody to say something to me, to say, even if I would not, even if it be offensive, but say something. You know, say something through the instrument, of course. I'm looking for the best human being I can find. That's number one in my book. The best human being, just somebody who really is loving life and has a dream of doing things, and of course has a good basic facilities, a good basic understanding of the instrument with articulation, with rhythm, which is the most important, very, very important, and all of that. But really where it boiled down, if I'm thinking of what made me take somebody, if somebody tell me a story that will convince me that, I'd like to hear more of his or her story, then I will be amenable. I put him in the acceptable box, where then I will listen again and again. I will, most of the time, I will meet him again, or I'll meet him before. So I have kind of I understand a little bit about them. But when they come to me, they can wow me, not with their fast finger. They can wow me with their voice. Mm-hmm. And that's important distinction, you know?
You mentioned articulation. Hermann said, as you said, you have a knack for diagnosis. And he said, his problem when he first came to you was articulation. That was the first thing he said. You remember this, I guess.
Yes.
Okay.
I remember many things, by the way.
But he, I don't want to put you on the spot, and so I don't know what's possible in a talk like this. But what would you do to solve articulation, like a general? I mean, we're talking about individuality now, but I assume that there's some technical things that. As you say, your different antibiotics that you might offer to people.
And it will differ from person to person. Uh-huh. It will differ from person to person. But I have to tell you, and I don't mean to be vague about that. Mm-hmm. First, I will listen to you talk. I will listen to how you pronounce, how is your diction, your mm-hmm. natural diction. When you talk fast, when you talk slow, when you talk, how you making the tongue, what is your natural from birth? So languages will change. That's why you hear some, I'm very fascinated with the connection between the language and the work of the tongue. So the first I listen to you talk, it's very interesting. The other thing, I developed few ideas that happened to help some people about articulation, but I believe it's all the secret is in three three areas. Is the point of the air, point of the tongue, point of the ambergy. If there was one deficiency on either one, tongue, air, or ambergy, your articulation will become a little bit more labored, a little bit more deficient. If it's really all set up well, the tongue will follow through, number one. I'm going to say something, again, vague, but I believe in articulation, the air is the secret.
Mm-hmm.
The air is the secret. The tongue will run, but the air is in the secret. And if you think that the air is behind the tongue, you're only very partially correct. In my opinion, the tongue is in, the air is in front of the tongue, and the air is on the side of the tongue. The tongue is immersed and covered totally with air. So if there is deficiencies, if the air is too low or too open and stuff like that, immediately it will drag the tongue to where it has to be. So you have to work on tendency, to change tendencies of what you're doing to learn certain things. If you stick to the those kind of ideas where the tongue, I have this analogy I give, because I used to do it in the Kinneret, the in Israel. You know, when you go to a lake and you skip a rock, you know, you skip rocks. I used to have 10 skips or 10 to 12 skips
Wow. On
the things. This is the best articulation I know, because the river and the ocean is the air.
Mm.
The air is already there. The air is moving. You're moving in front of it, you're moving in the back of it. Sometimes you move fast, sometimes you move slow, but it's moving. It's never static. Once you only put the tongue behind, the air behind the tongue, the air becomes static for a split second. So if you adapt this concept that the air is the secret, after you know that the three-point approach, point of the air, point of the tongue, and point of the ambergy, then you're already in the beginning of getting the tongue to float in your natural ways. But again, it's very individual. Some people have huge, very, very long tongue, which present different problems. Some people, because of their languages, the tongue is hiding and behind the bottom teeth, and too much is in the middle. So there are some other issues I do. We adjust it, or we relearn certain things. And there are many, many different issues. You cannot just pinpoint one thing for a person. I change my antibiotic. It depends on the person. At least that's the way I'd like to think about. Also, I might mention that I give an exercise that says, you on the column here, you pick different composers, Mendelssohn, Mozart, Schubert, Haydn. And then you on the other column, you say, okay, I'd like to know what is the type of cushion accent in Haydn or in Mozart. What is a carol in Mozart? What is a dot in Mozart style? So articulation cannot be one dimensional. It has to fit with the style that you're playing. So if you play Stravinsky, L'Histoire des Soldats in the high A, pa, 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 it's completely different approach, different accents than obviously in Mozart or even Brahms. Brahms needs to have the cushion. So you have to find a way how to create it. And most of the time it create by the resonance and the cushion of the air. The air. So anyway, you know, there's one thing also that I show my students. I show them that 95% of the time you have to have on the premises that it's a release, it's not attack. You have to, 90% of the time you have to touch to the reed just very, very lightly to stop the vibration of the reed. 95%, only 5% you have to go all the way to the hard rubber. And by doing that, I give some exercise to understand it, how light you have to touch just to stop the, to separate the sound. Mm. Once they get the sensitivity from the front of your tongue, then immediately it's freed the tongue to work faster and cleaner. Sorry, you opened the gate. And I just ran through it.
Great, man. It's like when a student comes in prepared and just like, great, my job's easy. So you're making my job easy. Thanks. No, I think this is exactly what.
Yeah.
No, I mean, just to take a break for this is exactly. I mean, from soup to nuts. I mean, COVID quote survivor. Attitude changes going on during this period and all these wonderful very you say you're vague but actually you're actually giving a lot of things that people can adapt to them so I mean this is exactly what we want. I just want to know one question. If someone comes in with a New York accent, do they have any chance of tonguing well and being accepted?
Absolutely, as long as you take the potato out of your mouth. No, okay. I'm just kidding.
So there is hope for me, you're saying?
Absolutely, okay. You must definitely.
Thanks. Yeah. We'll talk about Italian accent, though. I mean, that's hopeless.
Right? Oh, that's fantastic. That's, I bet you Lorenzo has very quick, very, very quick and very leisure. Yeah. It's a fantastic language.
Can we stop talking about what Lorenzo does so better than me? I'm sick of this.
Sorry.
I don't want to have to see a psychiatrist after this interview, Yehuda. Come on. Yeah. So I mean, you've answered a lot of my questions. Like, I wanted to. I mean. I know obviously that you diagnose each person individually. And I also did wonder, I don't know if you've answered the question, surely there's things that people take away. Hey, I studied with Yehuda Gilad for 4 years. So did I. Yes, he custom made a program for me, but surely there's commonalities. I guess I'm saying surely there must be things like, for example, I heard there's a Christmas tree warm up. Is that right?
Yes.
That's I'm hearing all the nicknames, but I don't know much behind it. Do you want to share some of these things with us?
The Christmas tree, it looks like Christmas tree. It's the premise is really stupid, but I call it so everybody knows what I mean. It's just idea of the sound and the blend. I have my own ABC that I developed for the student to have a checkpoint when they practice, and they seem to work very well. But the Christmas tree is part of the miscellaneous way that I like to do things to kind of build up, not only for the sound, obviously for the sound to find your sound, but also to make those corners, this part, right here, and the corners a little bit more to hug the mouthpiece more naturally. And the idea is like that. The high register, usually when you just start, is very shrilly and thin, very thin, right? Like that. So this is the top of the high. And the bottom register, when you start to play, is very tubby and spread, right? If you pull out the thing, you get the Christmas tree. Look like Christmas tree, right? I believe it has to be like a redwood tree, which there's a typical tree in California, in the redwood country, where the bark never thin up, only and very, very, very tough above. It stays like that beautifully. So I showed with a different concept what will get you to create it from bottom to the top. Sometimes with opposite of tendencies of what we have to do, sometimes with the different type of air, the warmth of the air, sometimes with the different kind of resonance that you have to do, but it depends on the player itself. So that's the Christmas tree. So I have an exercise that you start from E, very, very slowly. When you start to get fatigue here, and then you stop, you relax those muscles and you start from where you start. So it's chromatically, always relate to E. E, F, E, F sharp, E, G, E, G sharp, E, but very, very slow, like four whole notes. All the way to this E, to the middle E. Then from there you become the tonic and da di da di. So it helps you also with intonation and with the chromatic. And then when you go to here, to this E, the third E, then you do the same. And then back down. And by the end of it, it's very, very, the sound has connection to the bottom, and it goes more like you have to do it with ears. Always the ear is the most important. And then if you do it a couple of times, at least when they start to study with me, I like to have them, just to have the patience. I also believe in one thing, and that maybe it's more what I want to pass along to people, because everybody seems to be in a hurry studying. And the more patient you are when you study, and your study can be from the age of 18 or before until, let's say, 28, whatever. Mm-hmm. The more patient you are, you will get your dream sooner. You will get to accomplish your dream sooner. The less patient you are, the dream will be further away from you. And this, I know a lot of people say it in different ways, but I just want to bring my voice to everyone to say, incline it, because incline it, any wind instrument, any instrument for that matter, you have to be to educate yourself like an athlete. So I have those three pillars, which all my students know that. Three pillars. If you want to be a great musician, you have to be Olympic style athlete, where all the muscles are tuned perfectly. Your body has to be ready to create what the magic. You have to be very deep and profound philosopher to understand concept, to understand emotion. Emotion is not the heart. You don't play with the heart. You play with the emotion, which is in the brain, the thoughts. So the creativity, you learn poetry, you learn philosopher of the past, to understand of the kind of the distance of time, and to be able to play with the time, be able to actually measure the time, how far that we have. So nothing should be condensed and rushed and put together. Like the silence are the most beautiful music I know. So that's number two in the pillars. Number three in the pillars, you must have a great, great sense of humor. And yeah, from that standpoint, that you, the ability to smile, the ability to be positive, the ability to be sharing and inclusive, the ability to love all, that's number one. But number two, what does it mean, sense of humor? Or when you have a good sense of humor, your ego, your own ego, does not go in your way. And when a student come to me after audition or competition, he said, I played great. I played fantastic. I played, what's the common denominator? Is I. That means no good. It's all about him. It's not about the music and the beauty that he imparted to the audience. And the same thing, the opposite. When the student plays something and I ask him, how did you play? He said, I played awful. I failed. I did that. I did that. That's also, it's very selfish. So the point is like that. We are all, it's a hard enough job. And if you played few measures that really reach the heart of people, maybe that's a success. So please be patient and remember what your duties. it's not with mockeries, with fast blood like this. It was true honesty, and love, and the idea of connecting with people, constantly connecting, and bringing the beauty, not rushed, not false beauties, not everything has to be genuine. So I have this concept that I emphasize to all my students, and we're working on that in different ways. So, speaking about being athletes, my former students will tell you that I say quite often, muscles are dumb. The brain is very fast. So you can comprehend a method very quick, but the muscles, it will take you time to educate the muscles. That's why I work a lot on them. The brain, you practically can understand so much thing. Look, you have the iPhone here, you have so many things on computer, blah, 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 like this, but the muscles are dumb. The muscles just, you have to educate them. So that takes time, and time is your body, is your friend. Time is not your enemy. And all of those beautiful musicians that are coming out of schools now, remember, time is your friend, not your enemy. So anyway, that's
great. No, thanks. Hey, do you have a you're looking for someone with a story when they come to you? Not always a complete story, not even necessarily a nice story, and then you want to help them solve those problems and stuff. Is there a way that you actually try to bring even more individuality out in them, help them with their story once they're in your hands?
Yeah, plenty. But first of all, you have to, I gave this analogy in interviewed past. So if I repeat it and people heard it before, just put a chuckle on your face and take it in with grain of salt. somebody asked me the same question, but so I'm looking for somebody with a story. I kind of, the analogy is to look for the diamond inside them. There's beautiful things inside them. And then once I accept them, now it's my job. Now, so here's what I drew for my work on a kibbutz. In a kibbutz, of course, you have a dairy farm, you have a orchards, you have many different worlds. But in the dairy farm, when I worked there for very short time, because I was a pisher, I was nobody, right? So I had to clean those stalls. And what's on those stalls is pile of crap, So I started
the diagram. We got it the first time.
Okay, pile of crap.
We know what you mean.
What happened? That's exactly when I hear a student, beautiful, I hear the diamond somewhere. Then once they got to study with me, I start to get the shuffle. I take all the crap out. Then we bring the diamond with their own voice. And he said, now this is your choice. You see, this is beautiful. And the diamond is very small, but shiny and gorgeous. Now I tell the student, now you have a choice. Now you have a choice, either to cover it back up in the crap or to make this diamond even shine more and bigger and bigger and bigger. That's the analogy I give all the time. It's a perfect analogy. And this is what I'm looking. I'm looking for somebody that has very special somewhere in it, that of course has a good sense of rhythm, good sense of internet ears. Of course, you have to check those and good facilities, basic facilities. Yeah.
You say these important things and then you apologize after. Herman said that your mantra has always been, talking about yourself, you have to be yourself or you're not happy. And is this, I mean, I assume this is advice and what would you give right now? I mean, you yourself have been through COVID. You yourself have had 9 projects canceled, you know. It must be really hard. I mean, it's bad enough for the established musicians, but your entire, much of your entire universe is working with these people, young people now, who need hope, help, you know. And we're in the middle of a mess in a way. And what do you want to take the crap away from what I'm trying to say, and let's get to the crux. I mean, you want them to be themselves. What kind of hope? What kind of help? What advice are you going to give them besides just be patient? Where's this light?
Okay, it's a very good question, Andrew. And I was since March, since April, I was thinking about that. You know, in a long life, you have, it's always in waves. You have the ups and you have the downs. Let me show you something. May I show you something?
Please.
I'm going to take it, or I'm going to go from Mallorca to Gilad Casa.
Oh, good.
Just for a minute.
Okay.
And I'm going to write something on the board, which I show my students. Can you see the board?
Oh, great. Okay, you're all set up, yeah.
Where is that? Can you see it?
Yeah, no? We have a little bit of a glare. Is there a way you can?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
I don't know if I can help that.
Just move it, maybe. I don't know. Let's see.
Let me move it to here. I don't know if I can do anything.
About okay, I think that's a little better. Thank you.
Can you see?
Yeah. Very
interesting. That's one exercise that I give. But this is, it's really getting into too worldly.
Okay.
But look at that. Let me write it.
Okay.
Let me rewrite it for a minute. You see, when a student come to me, I said to him or her, I said, if you expect to come, your improvement to be from here to here, your demise will also be from here to here.
Yeah.
Straight line. Mm-hmm. But now this is my concept. If your improvement will be like this, and I will stand here like this, cascades and valleys, cascades in valleys, cascades in valleys, cascades in valleys, cascades in valleys. Then I will mark your improvement according to the valleys, not according to the cascades. Because you have times where you are playing and you say, this is the best concert I ever had. And you're inspired. That's right here. This is the thing that make you want to do this. Most of the time, musicians, like all of us, has frustrations, has angst, has impatience, has you are in a slum. And those are the valleys. I will judge if you get better according to this line, not according to this line. Does it make sense to you?
Yes.
So I'm going to start with this right now. So this is just something to show you what kind of patient you have to have. And sometimes the patient has to be longer, sometimes it will be shorter. So let's go back, and I would sit here and come back to you.
Yeah, that was a wonderful board and very informative, but as a personal favorite to me, can you put Mallorca back? It put me in such a good mood.
Of course.
Thank you.
Or
your dog, one or the other. Both of them put me in a good mood.
Yeah, my dogs are here, lying down here because of the thing.
It's okay.
Mallorca.
Great. So
You want me to put Hawaii?
Yes, that was a good one too. Perfect. Yeah, it was a little dark, but hey, Hawaii's all right. Great.
That's Hawaii. That's where I love to go as well.
Sure.
But anyway, but so here's what I'm going to say.
Yeah.
You see, this is the whole world experiencing probably something that hopefully we'll never experience again, but none of us experienced in the past.
Mm-hmm.
Is total global shutdown with the worst hitted that was hit are all the performing arts. No plays, no dance, no music, live music in front of the audience, which we have feed all the time. They feed us the inspiration to their listening, their involvement. No opera, no all of the culture and stuff like that. So this is very dangerous time in many ways because of it. And I said like that, for me, the most important part of it, of us, of all of us musicians, and the musician who teaches as well, is that we have a responsibility, especially during this period, to inspire and to make sure that the aesthetics is really a necessary part of the society.
Mm.
Right now, if you notice, the aesthetic has been taken away. And the only thing left, there will open bars, there will open businesses virtually, stock market, or they will open many things. And what left that they didn't open is the aesthetics, the study of beauty, the study of precious, of what the world is all about. And that's what happened. That's why my students and I believe the whole population is suffering this angst and this awful time, because they took culture out of anybody's life. Yes, you can watch TV, well, or you can hear a recording. You see how important is orchestras, how important is chamberies, how important is opera, because you don't have it. And so I feel that is my duty to do so. So what I tell my students, first of all, I always say, be inspired. Worst things, this is the pit. That's probably the worst thing that can happen to any human being, to be locked down like that. And more than that, it cannot go worse than that. So everything else is going to be positive now, because we all scratching the bottom of the barrel right now, as far as culture, as far as the future for those unbelievable students. So what I tell my students, now I would like you to wrap yourself in preparing yourself a certain weaknesses. Work on certain weaknesses that each of you has and create a project. You can create a project for classical music. Hit classical music only. And then the next ones, hit this one. If you have some issues with articulation, issues with breathing, issues with that, work on it now. Because and as soon as the world will open, it will be a tsunami of people that coming to any competition, auditions, or anywhere. And unfortunately, there will be not as many opening, because orchestras in United States, some of them are folding because there's no money. You know, it's like a vicious, so it will take quite a bit of time. It will take at least 2 to 3 years to recover. So I said to them that this time you have to find your projects that can enhance your love for music. So this is the number one that I can find. It's very easy to say, be patient for somebody that is studying, is in college right now, and they see only no possibility. Everything is a no, everything is closed, everything, there's no audition canceled. There is no hiring, there is hiring freeze. And you have to come up with the positive. And the positive is that worse than that you cannot find. And you have to be ready and to be inspired more than the other guy or other girl. You need to be inspired, and you have to kind of take care of all of the things that falling by the wayside because you're not as busy right now. So that's what I tell them most. And I work with a lot of people on, right now especially, on finding what exactly their angst, or what exactly their fears. And then we're dealing with it slowly, slowly. But remember, it's all boiled down to part of the angst is by the virus, what it did, it took away the most beautiful thing on earth is culture, is beauty, is describing of beauty. They took away and just took the aesthetics part of everybody's curriculum out. So you understand? So that's very hard for me, but the way I explain it is by showing them this one. Remember, some of the valleys take longer to recover. But as long as you recover slowly and still the trajectory is even. I'm a great believer in the humankind, and I am a great believer in our ingenuities and our love for the arts that we are doing, that I'm sure we all will come out of it eventually much stronger, much stronger. But it will take time.
Yeah, I mean, I could ask a few more questions, but I think this is just the right time. You yourself, a COVID survivor, someone who deals with primarily young people in the most vulnerable, if the seniors are the most vulnerable for health-wise, perhaps the age group that you teach are the most vulnerable mentally or in its own way emotionally. So, I mean, these are really great words, and I think we all thank you, and it gives us a little bit of motivation. So we have a COVID survivor. He worked on a kibbutz. This gave him this sort of humility in a way, and an ability to look at things in a certain way, with a beautiful Hawaiian sunset in the background. So I really don't want to spoil this moment. So we're going to sign off. We're going to thank everyone for joining us, and we're going to thank Yehuda Gilad, tremendously for meeting with me again. It's great to see you again and catch up and introduce you to our friend Lorenzo over here. And we just wish you all the best, and I hope you do succeed in getting the spirit out to young people and that they follow these words. So thank you so much, and great to see you again, Yehuda.
Thank you for the opportunity to share my thoughts and my love to all the people, and for my former students, wherever you are, big, huge hug, a virtual hug, and I cannot wait until I don't have to do it with my elbows.
Okay, Yehuda, all the best. Take care, everybody. Thank you for joining us again.
Bye-bye.